today, we're not having any reports, we're not doing anything like that. We're going to sit here and work, because we've got some things we need to kind of get back to. This is a little bit of the GAC's been, Bob's done a good job of getting us back tracking here. We still got a little ways to go. So the intent, and you saw on the agenda today, is we need to talk about our white papers. We've been talking about, ever since Jerry Yerrick passed away, we haven't had good white papers. And when Jerry Yerrick was still around, I mean, we had really good white papers. I mean, they laid out everything. And we need to just go over some calendar events, because we need to make sure that we're monitoring the calendar events, so we know where we need to be. We're POA board members. We have Kevin Sexton, who's not here today, he's on vacation, but working together to know where we need to have people from the village. Because you may get tired of the rubber chicken, or you may get tired of the cold scrambled eggs, but sitting at the table, I'll use an example, one of the very first events I attended for the village was a prayer breakfast. At my table, and we were, at my table was Dustin McDaniel. So the old timers will remember Dustin McDaniel, who was going to be on track to be our governor until his affair came out, and Bruce Westerman. So we get that exposure from that level all the way down. We just need to make sure we're there. And it may be just gripping and grinning, shooting the breeze with them, but they see us there. And we've gotten back into that. We just did some events there. We're starting to get back, but we need to make sure we're covering all those events. And the last thing is, let's start setting up for our speakers. Who do we really need to have in and kind of flow them in and out type of stuff? So we're knowing who, or have a good idea who we've got. Okay, any questions type of stuff here? It's going to be a whiteboard exercise type of stuff here. I will scribble stuff on the whiteboard, and at the end I'll take pictures of it and try to craft it. And between Stephanie and I, try to craft it into something that we can use to produce white papers, to produce our calendars, to do everything. Paul?
Can you provide copies or a copy of Jerry Yerrick's white paper to see what format he followed?
Man.
We use the term, I just don't know what's in it.
I may still have some back on a computer disk someplace.
I've got one somewhere.
You have it on a floppy disk somewhere.
Yeah.
or microfiche.
Microfiche type of stuff. But yeah, Jerry had a format that kind of, he had purpose, and we have what are our key talking points, and that's my kind of, and what's our background. So we all know.
Yeah, we got to read it.
You got to know, here's what we're saying. It's no different than, and Tamara can remind us, when you're in the Pentagon, you have an elevator speech. Basically, you have enough things you want to say, because you can get on an elevator if you're with your general or you're with some other type of stuff. You have enough points. That's all you want to do. You know how many floors you're going up and down.
But my elevator is 22 floors.
Well, we didn't have that much in the Pentagon, so you had to make it.
You don't want that many. You just want shorter. In fact, we had our airmen carry them in their pocket.
Yep.
Yeah, the 60 seconds.
So, okay. Any questions? Type of stuff here. Well, welcome, everybody. Let's start talking about some of the white papers we need to have. We need other white papers, we'll add them on. The first one I put on the agenda was roads. We're never going to get away from roads type stuff there. So what is our purpose? What is the purpose of the roads to us, or the road purpose? I see it as twofold. We want good access, but we're downtown or Benton and Bryan needs to have that, so we send their money that way. Does anybody kind of think about that way? What do we think when we think about roads? What do we want to say? What is our purpose of this white paper?
You're talking about outside the gates.
Outside the gates. Remember, we're an outside the gate organization. Inside the gates, that's Joni and other committees. We deal outside.
So safety?
Safety.
Safe travel.
Okay. Safety, which was a big issue a few years ago when we lost a villager. So we need that type of stuff there. What other things do we need to kind of highlight our need for roads? There's an economic. Economics. Getting to Hot Springs or getting to, how did we get the bypass? Mm-hmm. We showed that we need
Signage.
Okay. Purpose from our side is access. Because we want access to things outside the village. What's the purpose? What should we say is kind of correlate purpose for the locals? Business? I mean, economics? Isn't that really, what it really comes down to is you're thinking about what Hot Springs or Garland County or what Saline County wants from us? What do they want from us?
Money.
Money.
So it's money to the outside world. Besides your tax dollars, they want us pumping in our $400 million in economic impact.
Yep.
What are other things? What are some of the, as we look at the roads, what?
Security.
Security. Okay.
And access healthcare or ambulance, I don't know what.
Medical?
Medical, yeah.
What are some of the roads we need to think about that we want to push for? We did a very good job of pushing for a bypass. We did a good job many years ago of trying to get some improvements on Highway 5. What do we need to go back and get improvements on?
Specifically, which
specifics, one? Because these Glazy are the ones
Poe.
We, what's that?
Glazy Poe.
Glazy Poe?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The cutoff between 5 and 128.
They just resurfaced that.
They just resurfaced that.
Yeah.
What about our Highway 5 gate?
Intersection?
Intersection, yeah.
Okay. What other roads? I mean, we fought hard to get Danville, you know, Danville Road get fixed.
That bridge.
10 years ago. Those bridges.
What's the road that cuts off right there at the home plate, goes out towards the lake?
298.
298.
Strawberry Road, or whatever you call it, yeah.
Okay, do we think that's important to us? I mean, do
a lot of GPS from the west end will take you into Hot Springs.
Well, that's the route to Lake Washita. I mean, if you're going to the lake, you're pretty much mostly going that way. State Park, if you're going that.
Rob, for your business, how can we get more people to you? I mean, does Highway 7 need to work?
Well, kind of to your point a second ago, you know, 10 years ago, we did a lot of work on it, and traffic's continued to grow. It's continuing to grow, so turning lanes.
Okay. How about the Highway 7 intersection at
the Westgate?
Westgate.
Yeah.
Isn't that a beautiful intersection? That's what we're trying to avoid at the Eastgate. Yeah, we need a bigger turn lane, you know, to get people flowed off type of thing.
For sure.
Someone brought up GPS, and this isn't necessarily roads, but it's directions. Balboa Gate is what shows up on GPS, and people get stuck there because they can't get in. They need to go to the East Gate, and I don't know where that fits in, but you would probably be a hero if you could get the correct directions into the village for visitors.
Well, the other one, and I remember this story, one of our new general managers was directed, and where do you think they got directed when they came in? By the GPS.
Danville.
No, they got directed to Cortez Gate.
Oh, my gosh.
Gee.
He was coming in from the north, and he got directed to Cortez Gate. That was David Twiggs. That was his first exposure to getting in the village. That's where they brought him in. Of course, he ended up living
right
on the north side.
That's a rough one there.
What else on roads?
Signage.
Got signage.
Which seems to be bubbling up and up and up.
Okay.
You talking about road signs, or are you talking about advertising?
I'm talking those billboards that are now popping up on 5.
Okay, so you got signage two ways.
Yeah, no, I was looking for positive. I was looking for.
Oh my God! Now there's
throttling
more and more. They're awful.
Oh,
you're ugly.
On Highway 5. They're awful.
They just put those up.
Cherry Parker.
Must be the same one that was on 7 because.
Caldwell, they put two.
Yeah, they're huge too.
Three, I think.
Put took guy on the list to speak to the GAC.
Jimmy Parker?
Yeah.
Jimmy Parker. What else about roads?
What's outside the box in terms of, like, what's not there right now? Like, what roads do we not have that we need? You know what I mean? Like, the bypass we didn't have at one point and we needed it. Like, is there anything that's, you know, a different thoroughfare, different way, a different...
Different way in?
Yeah. Is there anything? I mean, I don't have anything in my brain. I'm just thinking out loud. Is there anything that we're not thinking of?
I'll tell you one that comes to mind for me is right east of Remax, that road that is a construction entrance that 19 years, I don't know what
Goose
it's...
Pond?
That's Goose Pond, yeah.
Goose Pond.
That's a village issue. That's a village issue, that gate there. That's the old construction gate.
What about the internet opportunity, like we're doing to lay it beside the road? Would that help the community outside if they had that technology? I'm sure it's the same cable companies or whatever they're doing that.
The issue is, outside the gates, they could run it high. If you think that's what first to connect it, doing why they're doing the village, we don't have the high, they're coming low. Outside the village, there's people wired up out in the middle of nowhere in western Saline County. The problem they have out there is they don't, it's affordability issues. So, any other kind of type stuff? If you had to say what was some of our key talking points, what would be some of the key talking points?
I would say medical and safety.
Okay. Okay. Anything else on roads? Again, I want to just lay stuff out here so we can build what we want to do, bring the white papers back to you.
Say, well, right. We're always pushing economic impact.
Okay.
And our own
money talks.
And both ways, right? Not just how much we spend, but how are we getting people here? Because I was going to, we didn't talk about like tourism, but when we have visitors come, what is the impression that they're getting on their way to the village?
Yeah, tourism is a big one.
Yeah. I mean, we're bringing in all these golf packages and all these people that are coming to the community and new resident prospects. And what do they see on their way from the airport? You know, what do they see on their way from?
I'll move that one right on top because that's it. We're trying to sell our village, but sometimes when they drive, they go, yeah, they're in Arkansas.
Yeah,
I mean, the first time...
Zoning and how they're managing the properties outside the gate matters, you know, and what you see, and it's...
The first time, the gentleman who was my best man, he came and visited us. He was coming out of San Antonio on Traverse, and which way do you think he was brought in by his GPS?
Gulf of Gorge and Fox Pass.
Nope. Brought him up I-30, turned him at 70, turned him on 128, and turned him on to Owensville Cutoff.
Yep. Mm.
He came up to me, he goes, where the hell were you guys?
How'd you find it?
You know, because Owensville Cutoff, which is a GPS route, there's some interesting, you know, folks back there.
Keith, I don't supply it, but just information, the acquisition, the roadway for our new road acquired enough space so at some time in the future it can be four lanes. And that was to accommodate future economic development. Someday Hot Springs becomes a major metropolitan area with a total beltway around it.
Okay.
That's so it's that's owned.
That's a good thing. Down the road, always thinking. It's like thinking about Highway 5 improvements. Not only the intersection, but someday, maybe, there'll be turn lanes. Maybe.
Or a passing lane.
Passing lanes. Because, you know, it was a major improvement that where we went to get it shoulders. I mean, how many people can remember Highway 5 before the shoulders were there? I mean, when those shoulders went in, it helped a lot. But we still, you know, run them off the road, even with the shoulders.
And Keith, conceptually, what's come up a number of times now is presentation or aesthetics or whatever the heck you want to call it, because I don't blame your friend or your best man for going, what in the world?
Yeah.
Because we have got some visuals around that are disturbing. I mean, you come up, oh my gosh, it's like, who allowed this clutter?
It's the county.
Right, and so who?
That's the challenge.
Some of it's just deplorable. Why allow anybody to be?
Because that's how Arkansas is, and people specifically want to live outside city limits because the counties do not have the same enforcement.
Yeah, look at Highway 7, that bypass. Those people always up there out in the middle. I'm like, wow, that's not good.
Absolutely. And I don't want to make judgments about other people, but I do want to make judgments about where I live and what kind of presentation I make to the rest of the world.
Yeah.
And when we think about, we go to visit other parts of America or the world, and you drive into a place, it could be a nowhere world, but it feels welcoming, comfortable, secure. The images present
I think that's
when you come up all these nonsense billboards and yuck. How do we affect the powers that be to make more sense of that? Unless we want chaos.
Zoning on here? Is the word zoning?
Well, we really don't have, zoning, does it really go on roads or does it go in economic improvement? But that's probably another thing that we as a village are going to have our internal zoning. But I will tell you, once you get outside the gates, they ain't changing. They are not changing. Because there's a reason they live in these areas. That zoning is a four-letter word.
But there's ordinances, and wouldn't there be ways for us to
influence
or request additional ordinances be put into place?
Zoning over here because it's more legislative or county type of action.
Yeah.
That's really.
But aren't there county ordinances that deal with property maintenance and? Right. But how do we, really and truly, how do we affect change there to get them to enforce their own?
There are some very basic things, but it really has to be bad to get any type of movement out there.
I've seen some bad.
I know Judge Mahoney, they were going back to the litter issue because there was litter so much in Garland County, and they're hitting schools and kind of redoing that.
Yeah. It's teaching the next generation, not to just drive up and come home from work and throw your beer cans out in the front yard, which is.
It's an uphill.
Okay, let's talk about economic development and improvement. What should be our purpose? What's our purpose? What do we want? We're not going to get a super Walmart in the middle of the road. I'm looking at Joe.
We do want commerce and certain needed businesses that any community should have. A grocery store being one of them, that's closer than 17 miles away.
So we still need growth.
Yeah.
In there.
Yeah.
Commercial growth, or you're talking about?
I think it's commercial.
Yeah.
Whether it's inside the village, like DG Mart, what they want to try to do, or if it's outside the village, whether it's either end. I mean, Highway 7 is definitely has a lot of commercial out there, but Highway 5 not doing too well.
Keith, the other issue is when you talk about that, you have to look at the village as a whole. What is it that they really want? Do they want commercial companies that you're talking about in here? Or did they move here so that they, you've got 16,000 people living here now. Did they move here because there wasn't any of that here? Believe me. I've got the lashes on my back.
I can imagine. DG Mart, I've read a bunch of that. So there are some people that.
And there's more to come.
Yeah.
But we're not talking about inside the gates, right? We're still talking outside the gate. What do we want?
This is for commercial economic development. This is where it goes into Kevin Sections. We kind of blur. It's inside and outside. What do we want to promote and try to encourage?
We also divide that again, Joni, between what tomorrow's residents want versus the 16,000 that are here, or half of those who came here 20 years ago.
Yeah.
it's like stratified.
So you have current versus future needs. Because some people don't want stuff because they want to be out on the cliff. And they're the same people that get mad because someone builds on their street.
That's right, not next to my house.
Yeah.
And we get that all the time.
Oh,
too.
Yeah.
So what we have then, we've got a divide, maybe multiple divides among our, and that's not a surprise. We have different goals and objectives. We might have moved here for different reasons. Okay, so, but we live in a gated, the largest gated community in America. Is that still correct?
Yeah.
It seems to me when you have a large gated community with an infrastructure, one needs amenities and resources to sustain the community. That's why I brought medical up. You know, we're a long way from even Hot Springs itself for medical care. Compared to living in North Dallas, Texas, Bob, where in 5 minutes I'm in a hospital, literally, or multiple hospitals, right?
Not in 5 minutes.
The traffic.
Where I am, within five miles,
one of our purposes for economic development, economic improvement, is to sustain our community. Think about it. That if we do not have some of these certain economic venues or whatever you want to call them, we might not be able to sustain our community. So as we change over, hey, someone does it, they want this. I'll use this kind of as an example of maybe one generation, the house of liquor was a big thing for them. Maybe another generation, they're not as big on the house of liquor, they're bigger on something else. I think of Rocky's store, that's Rocky's Liquor now, started to be a gourmet store, and it didn't do well.
Oh yeah,
didn't do well. But is that to say 10 years from now the gourmet store might be more important to people? It's as we change. Paul,
I want to go back to something that Stephanie said, or this inside the gate versus outside the gate, and I don't know what I'm saying, but I don't know if any of us want economic development or commercial development to go wide open inside the gates, but we'd certainly like it outside the gates so we have better access.
So one of the things I think the challenge is, so we need to think about, I'll just take Highway 5 and the East Gate. So once you leave our gates, you're in rural Arkansas. So water and sewer and the things that you need to have a successful commercial venture, aren't, the infrastructure is not in place for people to even open businesses or,
Exactly.
And so what is it that we would need to do through GAC to help get those pieces of infrastructure in place?
This is something, as we make a talking point, how can we help?
Yeah.
How can we help?
Right.
And we got to be open to some stuff and work it. This is, it's just challenging because you can help development outside our gates. Well, we got to figure out how we can do that. You got to work with Cooper. You got to work with the board. You got to work with it. But there are just certain things that if we're going to sustain our community, we're going to need to probably start thinking outside a little more.
Yeah. Keith, in my research on economic development grants, et cetera, there are 8 different regional economic development groups in Arkansas. Two, the counties we're involved with, one in Hot Springs and the other is, I think it's Lowenoke, but they're under the two judges. And that might be a good, they were not receptive to us as an unincorporated private, not-for-profit corporation. In fact, they said, well, you can't use our services. So maybe something along the lines of cultivating those economic development groups that already exist. They're trying to help people develop the area, bringing in trade schools, vocational schools, different kinds of industries. Maybe some kind of closer contact with them would be beneficial.
How is Hot Springs Village viewed by whoever these people are that we're talking about outside our gates, who have some sort of skepticism about us, perhaps, I don't know, we're some sort of odd foreign entity, maybe. If we don't bridge that communications and cultural gap, we are going to shake hands and move forward together into the next.
You want my opinion?
I'm trying to understand, yeah.
Garland County understands our importance to their economic, whether it be medical, whether it be Sam's Club, whether it be coming down there to eat type of stuff there. Saline County is focused on Benton and Bryant. We are, I want to say, Jim, you can jump in here. You've had 6 years sitting in a chair. A lot of times out of sight, out of mind in Western Saline County.
I think that's partially true in Saline County. It thinks north and east.
Yes.
For the most part. But the key to that, I mean, you start out with them thinking well of you and you having the relationships. And we had that. I will tell you, the Highway 5 improvements would not have happened without the push from Jeff Ferry. It simply would not. The politics of highway development are that nobody is more influential with the Highway Commission than county judges.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's some logic that when you get through that. So I don't think it's a leadership thing, but what happens is you got the economic development function going on and you can provide the housing, you can provide that, and then you get down to utilities, to public services, and you can have all the good relationships you want. But if somebody says, I can't buy public water and sewer down there.
Yeah, that's the biggest problem.
I'm going over to Highway 7,
yep,
where I can.
Mm-hmm. And even, you know, Highway 7 has went through, what was it, the North Garland Sewage District or whatever, then that whole big hassle.
That was a big mess.
Big mess.
Lots of
but
lawsuits.
It's still developed there. Highway 5 hasn't developed because you go across the street of Highway 5, that sewage system there,
We've suffered on Highway 5, and I'm pointing fingers, but I don't even know who I'm pointing fingers at, from bad ownership of commercial facilities over there. So,
private ownership. Yeah. Private ownership. You know, the point is, we would not have the new road, and I won't beat this one to death, without the economic impact study that was done by the university. Now, the first couple of times we did it locally, and Jerry did a great job and doing it. But when it was done by the university and we went through some of the activities we did, they couldn't argue from the standpoint, well, that's just the village, you know, saying something that may not be accurate. Now, best of my knowledge, and I could be wrong, Keith, but I don't think we've done anything with that now for the last 3 years.
No, we've used it. In fact,
updated it?
No, because we do it on a 5-year basis.
Well, we
updated in 21.
More problems than just the 5-year basis.
Yeah, 5.
The guy that did it retired, and the university has not refilled that position.
Right.
He is willing to do it again, but the most important thing is getting the university's logo on the front of the thing, so we've got the credentials for it. I don't think he'd be able to do that, and he wouldn't have access to that, and he wouldn't have access to the students to do the legwork.
Yeah, to follow up on what you said, they've hired a new director, but they've also redesigned his job description, so economic development reports aren't high on his list. They still do them, but they're not the priority. So, you know, we'd have to do some, you know, arm twisting to get it done there again.
It doesn't and have to
the
be
other
that
thing
the
is
university.
The cost.
There's other
people, yeah.
Yeah.
The challenge we're having right now is, and I will use the last time that the 2021 economic impact study was used. The locals, and I'll be very honest with you, the locals just, yeah, great type of stuff. It may not have that with the current philosophy of our outside neighbors. It doesn't carry as much weight as it used to be.
It's a function of new dollars versus old dollars. $400 million in economic impact
to the village
is already here.
Already here.
They don't have to do anything to get it. When Top Golf got announced in Little Rock, it was on the nightly news. We're going to bring $25 million into this town. It's great news. We've been working on it for years.
See, they're taking us for granted now. We're part of the, we're already figured into the equation. So when we go out and promote how much we bring, oh yeah, you've been doing that for years. Okay, what's new? What have you done new for us? What have you done for us today? You know, we're not going to go out and build a new golf course. We're not going to do this. We're not going to do those type of things. Well, that's the challenge.
But you know what? We do have a story in there somewhere. I mean, I'm just going to use the golf thing right now, just simply because, I mean, we went from, what, $200,000 in revenue for golf packages and people coming into the community to well over $1 million a year. And that's just tourism. Those are people coming from Texas, driving those highways, stopping at restaurants, you know, staying in hotels. There, you know, there is a story there that is new revenue, new money.
Yeah.
I don't know how you get the specifics of what they are, but there is a
number. I mean, he knows how many.
I mean, if we're generating $1 million plus in just golf fees, think of all the peripheral things.
Right. So where are they staying? Where are they?
Yeah. Where are they staying? Where are they eating? Yeah. Where are they buying their gas? What are they? Right. You know, I mean.
Yeah, Keith. Yeah. I'd like to follow up on what Arnie started. The conversation drifted away from it, but I think, and this may be POA board level more so than governmental affairs, but I was asked many times to describe the village. People would describe the village to me, and it was not an accurate description because we have grown and we have changed. So I think a white paper that helps each of us talk about the village in terms of what is the village today. I talk to somebody about grants and they say, oh, well, you're a nonprofit corporation, you're a community of rich golfers, you don't need any grants. You know, so there are all kinds of perceptions out there. Met a young man the other day, and this relates to how the village is changing. He said, oh, yeah, I've got some relatives that live in the village, and they're just loving it. The amenities are great. It's such an active community. And they work from home. So they're not old, they're not retired. They are different, yeah, different demographic.
Yeah.
And how do we, as representatives of the village, how do we describe the village to other people? When I moved here 7 years ago, all of my wife's relatives looked at me and said, do you know what you got into? There's nothing out there but old folks. I said, well, I am one. You know, but you know, so I think a white paper that helps us describe the village, all of us, board level down.
Well, that goes into describing our demographics.
Yes.
Which are changing. So, Jimmy, how many school-age kids do we have now?
Well, it's been 1,000. I don't know if that's
I think it still hovers in that thing.
Yeah, it's still about 1,000. There's only 200.
But you tell people that, they're shocked.
Oh, yeah.
They're like, what? Mm-hmm. You have 1,000 school-age children in the village of old people? Well, yeah, because the demographics are changing.
Demographics are changing.
Do we have any idea how many people work from home in the village that are using those services?
Nobody would be good to know, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
We'd go hear broadband work from home numbers.
You know, maybe that's one thing that, we focus on the economic impact study, but, I mean, we need to pull the pieces out of that that are most important. Demographics are probably as important as are the dollars being spent? You know, I mean, what are the things that we're focused on learning from that?
You know, I think Ron's work speaks to how the village is changing, can change in terms of attracting medical profession here.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, yep. To live, to bring their facilities, the bypass, you know, just makes that so easy now.
There was there's a move now, I think it was on Today Show, where young people are moving to retirement communities golfing communities because they took up golf in COVID because they couldn't do anything else but get outside, mm-hmm. and they love it. And so now, as a trend across the country, is these young families are moving to senior golfing communities because they feel safe. They're taking up golf. Mm-hmm.
So, and I mean, they work at home.
And you can work at home.
Right, absolutely. If you have internet, which is like...
that's expanded a lot, and it's expanded. Yeah.
This has nothing to do with the work session, but just last week, Walmart has increased our delivery zone to 30 minutes from the store, which covers about 98% of the village.
Oh, I didn't know that.
On Next Door.
I saw that. Yeah, that was on Next Door.
Next
they
door.
Were so excited.
Yeah, people on the east side, you know.
Oh, wow.
So
yeah.
If you're working from home and you can get your groceries without leaving the house, and,
that's
you know,
pretty
it
awesome.
Becomes
yeah.
more of a... you know, a decision, you know, easier for younger people to say, well, I can't move there because I got to drive an hour just to go get anything. You know, mm-hmm. but now it's all brought to you.
It's nice.
Well, just think Amazon. Yeah. You know, you order something, the next day it's here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a niece who lives here. She's an Amazon. You know, she's ordered, the next day it's there. We open our mouth and say something, the next day, you know, she has it for us. Hey,
we can have it to you in 2 hours.
2 hours. Bad word, Amazon.
I'm just saying.
No, but
2 hours.
I didn't know that about that.
You know,
awesome.
The other thing is, the people here in Arkansas do not know what the village is.
I had no idea. Went to school at Arkansas Tech, drove to the races down Highway 7, and Archie, he lived in Louisiana, told me about the village. I go, is that in Hot Springs? Because there's no advertisement of it.
That's why you think you're at Hot Springs, but you're really not.
A friend of my son's called me one day and said, Johnny, we're looking at purchasing a business, and we've never been to Hot Springs. It's a franchise type thing. And she said... we've always lived in Arkansas. We've never been to the village. They live in Little Rock. I mean, it's just incredible.
Well, see, that really ties over to Kevin. He's saying, what are we doing as far as promotional side from inside? And I know they're doing a lot, but you know, getting to focus in a lot on
other
Chicago,
things, but,
Houston.
Yeah.
But we used to focus on Little Rock. I mean, because we weren't focusing, and Stephanie, you can talk about this, you know, how many, five years ago, we backed off of going to all these other places and kind of tried to focus on Arkansas. Mm-hmm. So we've been through this cycle. So.
And that's a different message than marketing message. I mean, there's a different thing that we're trying to do. It's like,
And that touches on a point I was going to say, and at every point in here, be it this committee, be it whatever, setting these objectives, goals, whatever you want to call them, and giving them continuity is vital. I mean, we change focus every 2 years, and you know, we've all been honest about having a down period even with this committee. We need to ensure that the target market is going to be the same in 2 years that it is
today. Shooting here, shooting there, shooting here.
You know, and a part of that is dealing. We got more business people here because of the internet. Well, we can do a lot more for them if they are a market. Now, over here, we got all these people that says we don't want all these young people in here. And that's something to deal with. But we have not defined what we want to be. And until we define what we want to be, then you can't design what kind of roads you need here or what kind of medical support you need here. And I mean, that's my view. And not just define it, but maintain it. Keep
continuity.
It.
And that's the hard part. That's the one thing
I hesitate to start talking about planning, but
well, and that goes
what
back,
planning does for me.
Goes back to Cooper had the continuity of 30 years. They had their focus.
Yeah.
They changed a little when they start going, hey, golf courses, we can make some more money on golf courses.
But they kind of stayed on that path until about 2005. And they handed it off to POA, and the POA has been there, there, and everywhere. It's a challenge.
But something else comes to mind, in terms of, we are quite a sustainable and sustaining entity, quite frankly, given the, not that we are subject to the vicissitudes of economic whatnots, ups and downs, but given the the essential core of the population here, most of us have pretty stable incomes, no matter what, right? Because of where we are in life with retirement packages, our resources are in place to the greatest extent, more than probably most communities. So we aren't quite subject, we're subject to, but not maybe, is a theory, the ups and downs that a lot of other communities might, like large cities, which go up, down, and who knows what. That's a pretty strong point. We're here, whether you like it or not, no matter what the times are.
Well, I put that over here for legislators. That's because we deal with our politicians.
Yeah.
Hey, we're here.
Yeah.
And guess what? We're not worried about as much about the hourly rate versus we're making sure that the Social Security CPI, we're more worried about that.
Right.
It's going to be stable. You're not going to have these big fluxes. How many people are getting laid off of Social Security right now? Mm-hmm.
Don't we have one other quality, though, that maybe is not as positive, and that's high attrition because of age? So as we have this great attrition of people mm-hmm. moving back or moving away, we can have a negative effect on the state's economy and the surrounding community if we start to decrease.
We're not replacing.
Well, that's a good point. What's the data? What does the data tell us? Do we replace easily or is it hard to
replace? We're still replacing.
We're still replacing.
Actually, Central Arkansas was in a not replacing mode for a few years because births died off.
Yeah.
And COVID killed them off. But now it's starting to come back up. And the village has already kind of stayed as a growth.
But to Paul's point, that's an excellent question because absolutely. When you see I see a for sale sign and say, who are we losing? But what are the numbers tell us? What do the facts tell us about our replacement values here in the village?
Yeah.
Are we stable? Are our ups and downs greater or small?
The one thing that brings Arnie is what attracts people to Arkansas? Attractive cost of living. Why are we getting Californians moving in here? Why are we getting a bunch of people from Texas moving in here?
Yeah.
Because they know they can live here.
Mm-hmm.
It's a more bigger bang for their buck. I mean, they sell their 1,400 square foot. I mean, have my neighbor who moved back basically sold his 1,500 square foot house in San Jose for basically $1 million. He had already owned a house here. He moved back here.
Yeah.
Now he's working from home until he can retire. But how many of those other folks are showing up here?
When I moved here, a friend of mine told me, he said, "You'll love Arkansas. It's Colorado light. You get nice people, you get great scenery, and low cost."
Mm-hmm. How many of the trades do we support, and where does that fit in? Economically, we are probably 80% of the revenue for plumbers, roofers, electricians, yard people. I mean, small business.
Yeah.
And we need more of them.
We need more drivers.
Try to find.
We need them to show up.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, let's go on. Let's talk about medical. I think this one is probably one of our easier ones to handle because we've done a lot, but we got to stay up on it. Because the minute we lose our focus, and I think we lost our focus the reason it's here about 2013, 14, we kind of lost some doctors, and it really got skosh. And all of a sudden it started to move back. I see the purpose of this one is to maintain and improve our medical. We can't let it go where we saw it going. When the Bodemans cleaned out of here and cleared out of here and left that building, which we still have today sitting there, of an eyesore. And then we went through the CHI, St. Joseph, St. Vincent, when we were there. We had the National Park just kind of doing whatever National Park was doing. We were in a period where, hey, I can't find a doctor. But we've come through the period where we have the doctors right now. We need to maintain those doctors and still improve. The specialists, I think, is probably the biggest one. Ron jumped in, I think. But we have specialty folks that are at least coming in. So, I mean, the specialists, you know, here, because that's always, you know, a problem. Do I need to drive to Little Rock? Do I need to drive to Hot Springs?
One point. you know, for years, and I've said it both in St. Joe's and St. Vincent's Board, and we still have representation on St. Vincent's Board. John Weider is there. We have never had anyone in the village sitting on the board at National Park. I discussed this with my heart doctor the other day. He's from down there. Look at it, and I said, you know, given the number of people and the demographics and all the rest of it, we ought to be a player. I don't know that somebody here probably has better information than I do, but if you said, how many emergencies leave the village and go to National Park or go to St. Vincent's? I don't know. You know, the road was, you know, it's 10 minutes from that 5-7 junction to the emergency room now at St. Vincent's.
How is that decided? Is that the person in the ambulance, or is that
a choice? A lot of times, Bob, it's decided by a doctor.
Yeah. The doctor, your doctor?
Yeah, for instance, my doctor is at National Park.
Okay.
And so even though I'm sitting on the St. Vincent's board, I go to the hospital, I go to National Park.
But the first level of decision is the patient's.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, their instruction first is to take you where you want to go. I think that's the answer.
But I think we be involved in that.
That's right.
And we're not. Never have been.
We need to look at health care inside and outside the village, because most of the providers are owned by someone outside the village. So there's a number of things. And information, there's a lot of people that don't know what we have in the village. And my card groups and stuff, did you know we've got a cardiologist over here, a Good Samaritan, we have this over here, and well, we don't know of anybody taking new patients. Well, National Park just got a new female physician started at their clinic just outside the West Gate. They've got a new CEO I met at our brunch. I think we need to really keep close contact how we can work together. Another situation, I have some friends that had a daughter in Connecticut, internal medicines, and said she would like to consider moving to the village. Be closer, so the grandson can be closer to the grandparents. Long story short, I was able to get her CV, give it to Dr. Ross. She's now full-time at the Westgate Clinic, and she lives in the village. Another thing I think...
Yeah, that hits right here, attracting medical professionals to live here.
What can the village do to help us attract healthcare professionals to the village and to here? Is there some kind of incentive package to get them to visit, working with the hospital, the providers? I think not only doctors, but nurse practitioners, PAs. What can we do to get them to live, not only come here, but to live in the village? What can we do to give them make sure they get a tour? Well, that's the communication we have with administration at these hospitals and healthcare providers. Very important, I think.
You know what else is, kind of what you were saying about the village, how we're made up. I mean, we're covered. The community at large has health insurance, whether it be Medicare and supplement or whatever. Where in a city, I mean, that's an attraction to the medical community. That if you're out here, there's a good chance you're going to get paid. Yeah. You're going to get paid.
Exactly.
And when you're not in a city like may or may not, you're having a lot of people that are writing those bills off.
Well, and people coming from many parts of the country, as has been noted, get a raise just by moving here.
Yeah.
So often we talk and we focus on Chi St. Vincent and National Park. I think we've got to somehow link in the Heart Hospital, the Genesis, the specialty areas, and we seem to believe, in fact, Benton, we've had some contact, but it seems like a different tier.
The CEO at Celine has left, and they got an interim CEO, but we need to keep that contact with them. We had a representative from the Heart Hospital, if you remember, came. Sure. Keep those contacts. Find out what's going on. Well, important.
More than keep the contacts, don't we have to support them and actually link them into that strategy you're talking about on bringing a workforce to them?
Yes.
Through Hot Spring Village?
Yes, absolutely.
So I met a girl last night at a party, a 4th of July party. She lives here in the village. She's the head of the OR department at the Heart Hospital. Yeah. I mean, and she lives here with her child who goes to Fountain Lake on the golf team. I mean, like, she's part of this community, you know, and that's where she works.
And I think that's one of the challenges we have is both ways of going there. I mean, Jim used to sit on Celine Memorial, board, but then Celine Memorial got sold. It turned into commercial. It turned out everything else. We really lost money. Saline County lost a lot of, not influence, but any exposure. Mm-hmm. And then Heart Hospital came in, but how many people that they make the jump? They're going on Highway 5, they're headed up to UAMS or Baptist up there, or big, CHI type of thing.
I don't know if this is directly medical, but sometimes in the back of my mind I have some concerns where our long-term care or our housing, our good Sam with the sale and with Mount Carmel, and whether we have the ability to support our residents even now.
Well, just think about it. When my mom moved here, I put her on the list for Mount Carmel for the houses, and then for good Sam, 2-year waiting list. You know, once it lasted about 6 months, and she was entrenched in my second bedroom, she wasn't moving, so. So there was no, I could have had it, if I only had her in there for a month, I could have put her in there. But then once she got set up and she ain't moving.
We really need to continue to look at EMS. As you and I know, there's a situation, if you go outside these gate and you're over a dogwood tree, you're not gonna get the EMS service from the village, which is 5 minutes away. You're going to get it out of Saline County.
It's coming out of Benton.
They're going to come out of there, and it could take them 45 minutes to get there, where ours is 5 minutes away.
Yeah.
We need to see what we can do to have a relationship with the two ambulances to back each other.
That's all business. It's all business.
That's a good point, though.
Yeah, if you fall, drag yourself across the street to Highway 5, life will be responsible.
Yep.
And have someone drag you across the street. You literally, that's because that's life nuts one side of the street.
Yep.
Okay, broadband continues to be an issue. It will always be an issue until we're probably all, because it's going to keep on getting more and more type of stuff here. But I will fill out something on broadband here, but we still have the needs. We still have people that are sucking gas on broadband.
So it's still, not still, but it continues to be very spotty in the village?
There are places,
very spotty.
That little gate area is terrible.
Bob's area is spotty. up where I live. Well, Ron is a classic example. He just got First to Connect, their new technology, run through his street to give him an option. It's going to give him an option, at least. You have areas, Larry Siner, who's on the board with Joni. You know what Larry's internet speeds are? Anyone guess? 10 megabyte download, 1 megabyte upload. We're talking about gigs, and Larry's going, I got 10-1 type of stuff.
No streaming happening in his house.
No, there's no streaming happening in the Keck house, so when Mother Keck has a TV on, you know, my wife has a TV on, and I have a TV on, they're all different stations. There's no way we could stream. So we have areas. Benifar is an area, Masuro Way, those are, and this is more staying on the state, because the ISPs are trying to drive the dollars. I'll be very honest with you, they're trying to drive the dollars versus the customer's service type of thing.
Where's Little Rock in all this?
As far as
coverage.
Making sure we have broadband throughout the state. Not just
There's a whole broadband. I was at a conference last week. There's a Arkansas broadband office. There's $1 billion that needs to be divvied out. But what you kind of see is the divvying out is the probably the providers that are most reliable aren't going to go after the dollars because it's a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
So you got other folks that are looking at dollars, and there's been out-of-state firms that have come in and sucked up dollars. Tied up dollars, and they probably will never produce. That's a reality of life.
This issue's been the most gummed and most visible issue I've heard in the last 5 years, without any movement, it seems like.
There's slow movement. I mean, there's slow movement right now. It's the slow movement of First to Connect with this new technology. Hopefully, it's going to be cost effective because there's areas that if they can get that technology in, they will light up. And the competition is the 10-1. And they, at the lowest, I think it's 200 download or 200.
200, 500.
Yeah. At 200.
I have too. It's awesome.
And it just jump right in there.
It's at your house.
At my house, yeah.
Yeah. So, and to getting, there's another other firm, Hyper Fiber, who is getting ready on San Sebastian. You think of where Deborah's is? They planted their bases there. That's where it's input. They're going to head up San Sebastian. And they're starting very quickly.
So what's your definition of purpose for broadband?
The purpose is to bring HSV into the 21st century.
Yeah.
It's covered
there, coverage for all people.
Yeah.
I mean, there shouldn't be anyone without
it's
access.
Coverage,
it's security,
and competition. Because
my whole street, those are no, I do have it. It's awesome. Yeah, I took it.
Because how many of you only have? I have one choice. I take it or leave it. How many of you have only have one choice? Take it or leave it.
That's
horrible.
And guess what? As soon as they don't. Yeah. Oh, yeah, we gave you your special 1 year.
Yeah.
Then you got to go fight to get another promotion back. Mm-hmm. Type stuff. Now, at least you have a choice. Ron, one of Ron's neighborhood golf was saying, yeah, I just got told by Optimum they're going to jack up my rates $20 a month. Well, that made no sense to me. I just went over and signed up for First to Connect.
Well, put that in your talking points. Choice.
Choice. Well, that's why I say competition, choice.
Yeah.
Coverage and choice.
Yeah.
Keith, there's billions of dollars out there, and right now commercial firms are getting most of the state federal money. Is it worthwhile talking about or even considering the village being its own utility owner in this sense?
At this point, it's too late in the game.
It's
too late. I'll be very honest, that was discussed.
It was discussed
5 years ago when this kind of kicked off. What if we become our own ISP? You got too much, not so much, there's so many companies out there trying to fit into the niche. These people are going to,
I would agree probably at this point, the most efficient and the most expeditious is to rely on the commercial industry to supply this service to us, this utility. Hopefully it'll be successful. What if it's not? We've had one group in that wasn't successful.
About First Connect? Look, First Connect has already focused back on the new technology because they still have a commitment to everybody. They have a commitment to run it up to Bob's house when they might get there, but if you know, their new technology works out. And the technology they are using is the same technology that Hyperfiber is using coming out of it. Hyperfiber, these people are aggressive. They are very aggressive. And the good thing about Hyperfiber is they are on a franchise fee type of thing. I don't know how it works out. The POA is actually making a small amount off of Hyperfiber's usage. So. Okay, legislative. What's our purpose here?
Revenue. Being at eligibility.
Yeah, trying to break that code.
Yeah.
Gain eligibility, okay. For funds?
Well, tax deferment.
Okay, tax deferment. Tax deferment, tax exemption.
Indemnity.
Indemnity?
Indemnity.
I don't know if that's spelled it right or not.
I'm not sure I said it right.
Okay. Background recognition. I'll say this, does everybody understand what I'm saying?
Is that like, kind of, it's like, does that tie into education or?
Ties into, besides Richard McGrew, Matt McGee, Lanny Fight, and Mary Bentley, anybody knowing or caring about the village?
Well, that's what I meant. When I said education, educating them about the village.
Yes.
Yeah, education about us to our legislators.
Perhaps even representation.
What about educating ourselves about them?
That's a good point.
About how politics runs?
Or does it?
Well, case in point, and Kelly brought it up at the board meeting, we've been everywhere trying to get help with the tornado cleanup. We didn't get any help anywhere, no matter what their websites say. For the village, no. Because we're a private community. How many of these people does this private community let in to work here? When I say educate ourselves, start pretty local with the quorum courts, the reps on the courts. They all, I mean, that's not a full-time job. They all have businesses. How many of these businesses come to the village to work? Those people should be supporting us. I don't care what area they represent. So why don't we educate ourselves?
Yeah, Joni, I would agree with that, and I think the research I did about grants and state, federal, local, the entity that we are, we're in a different system as a non-profit corporation. The rest of the world deals in a different system. They deal in incorporation, in municipalities, in townships, in counties. That's their language. That's how they relate to us. And we, you know, You know, I felt so sorry for Kelly. I was at that meeting where you all made that presentation. That group didn't know how they could help us as the entity that we are. They can't.
We don't fit the box.
If they figure it out, they don't want to respond because
they don't want to help.
They don't want to help because we're the wrong entity. They don't have to.
We put our tax dollars in.
That's right. We do everything.
And we are good
yep.
citizens. And
better
we try
than,
to increase that.
Yep. And they're
the last few years.
They're living off our revenue.
They're living off of our money and getting the interest rates off of it.
The fact is, they don't have any obligation to do anything other than treat us like non-incorporated rural residents of Saline County or Garland County.
And keep sending them money.
And we keep sending them our money. So are we being smart?
That's it. I think we need to be smarter.
Yeah.
We may have to continue to send our tax money.
We're always going to send
our
tax
money. But we need to educate ourselves on every one of those court members. How many of them come here?
They don't have an obligation to assist us?
They do not feel they have an obligation to assist.
They do not feel or they do not have.
I think it's both.
I quit setting my. I'm not going to send my check to Garland County then this fall.
I think it's both. Okay. And
you'll see me in the paper too.
Depending on the circumstance, they'll pick their posture. But if we are a different entity that plays in their system under their nomenclature, their rules and regulations, they don't have those options anymore. They've got to deal with us.
See, that's how, as we look, and I mean, there is Richard McGrew is working on something for us. Whether or not it will be able to be pushed through is another question.
Right.
But it's changing, trying to change something. Just like there was a change a few years ago that allowed us to get, had to get the police department, I'm trying to remember what it was. It happened, it was just a small little thing, but it was a little bit of change. It's small change trying to build on it. The problem is we're to the point where we need some bigger change. So we're taking bite-sized pieces and trying to put our way in there where we really need a big chunk because of things that Bob was talking about, how we're perceived and stuff like that.
The other side of that coin is also, we had that discussion when we met over at the restaurant. I mean, I think that we have been living under some false assumptions about what it means to incorporate, in terms of gates and all that. It does not mean your gates come down. It does not mean your roads go to heck in a handbasket. So you have to think again about it's not just them that has to adapt us. We might have to adapt you.
That's why I have that. How do you
change?
How do we change potentially to fit into what legislatively is already out there?
Yeah.
Because there are potential avenues that we could slide into and be able to access funds, and they can't say, they can't stop us. The counties can't stop us.
Yeah.
So how does KMAC Village do it?
What's that?
KMAC Village, how do they get emergency funds and...
Okay. It's a gated community inside Little Rock.
Little community. I don't think they got emergency funds when they did for the tornado. Because everything happened and it was large enough.
Right.
That was one of the problems for the tornado here.
It wasn't. They didn't declare it a disaster.
The state would call it a disaster.
If the state had declared disaster in Garland County, we would have gotten HUD, or not HUD, what was it?
FEMA. We could have gotten into FEMA.
FEMA.
Dollars
just
there.
Like we did the last time.
That's how we got before.
But that was even, because I was at Camp Robinson then, and the emergency manager were like, what do we do with Hot Springs Village?
Because it's Garland County.
And they did come in, but that was when it came through Balboa area years ago.
Yeah.
It came in, but it was declared.
Yeah, it had to be reached that level. The state never declared us because it was major to us internally. But you think outside the village, you had a little bit on Highway 7 and a few trees down right outside on the Saline County side.
Don't we have a lot of work to do in educating our own members, our residents, on what we can't do under our current structure and what influence they can play in helping to change?
We've talked about that. So, like, I'm with Arkansan. So, rallying Arkansans who came from Little Rock or Conway, because they might have went to school with that legislator that, hey, can you help us with this, push this through? Because, like, we have 28 couples from Helena, West Helena. I mean, my neighbors are from Little Rock and Conway. I mean, so trying to get reach back to them, to their potentially high school classmate that now is a legislator for the state of Arkansas. Because otherwise, they just care about their little piece that they're representing. How do we get them to, you know, rule in our favor or vote on our...
You know, I think it may be until we're an entity they can help, we have to do things like what's happening right now in the legislature. We're trying to get a little bit of existing legislation changed by changing a word or two or the size of the area, number of people in it, you know. That's all we can do as the type of entity we are. If we're a municipality, then they have something to help.
Right.
They have something to help at the county, state, and federal level. But as a nonprofit corporation, we're on our own.
So is Bella Vista the same as we are?
No.
No, they're incorporated.
They're incorporated for all their type of stuff.
They have
that's the issue.
Municipality in there, if you
will. POA. The only thing the POA really has, POA owns the water system up there.
Okay.
And a small wastewater. Most of Bella Vista's on septic.
And the amenities. When you incorporate, you can negotiate who owns the amenities, who owns the utilities. Everything is up for negotiation. It's not like you're giving your soul away. It's not like you're giving away the thing that you like the most.
So why would we not incorporate then?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Those are questions that are being talked about.
Yeah.
We have to research this. And Jim's not here, but in 2011, based on the 2010 strategic plan, we had a tasking to review alternative governance. It was reviewed, and we had some other issues in the village going on, basically 11, 12, into the situation was just kind of, we got to get through to the financial side of the house. Now we're back, we're financially healthy. Not economically healthy for us, but what's politically, governmental healthy for us? And be able to look at it and say, here's the potential options we have. And I will tell you, these two gentlemen have been doing a lot of legwork on that. So, but it's not ready to kind of, you gotta go through this whole process. And it's gonna be a huge education process.
I wonder what percentage of we villagers understand our governance structure.
I don't know.
That's what he just said.
Listen to this. I mean, holy smoke! If I went around my neighborhood and knocked on doors and tried to have conversations, every conversation might be different.
It would.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Guaranteed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And don't forget, most of them moved here to retire.
Right.
That's why they're here.
They don't really care.
Just as long as they get a tea time,
that's right.
Just a court time.
They have electricity, water, sewer.
As long as they
you don't raise their coffees.
As long as they don't lose anything they currently have, you know, that's okay.
Yeah.
Kimmick Village, by the way, was annexed into the city as part of the city.
Oh, was it?
Is it? I just know that they still have a mayor.
What village?
Kimmick Village still has a mayor because he actually came to Metro Plan one or two times.
Yeah.
That's 700 people.
But it's still, but they...
All the services are provided by
the city. It's on Wikipedia. You can read about it.
They have private sanitation.
Okay.
Yeah, but they have Little Rock Water.
I got all those things. I'll get some pictures of them and start
putting
together.
Oh, what'd you do with that? I was going to take a picture.
On the back
of the
back.
Oh,
okay, a few other things that I just want to cover briefly. Calendar, if you can think of other events we need to start covering, please let me and Stephanie know, because we're trying to build a calendar. You know, the chamber events, you know, whether it's an annual chamber banquet we need to be just sitting there eating the rubber chicken. Now, how many, Stephanie, do you get to go to a lot?
I eat a lot of rubber chicken.
Rubber chicken. Prayer breakfast, I think we're set up to go to the Garland County prayer breakfast, but there's other types of things. And again, it's just being there. It's 6:30 in the morning.
Yep.
And trying to...
Why do you not have the quorum court meetings on there?
Okay. I'm hoping...
We have a representative.
...that Karen continues to represent so we don't have to send someone over to Saline County.
Yeah, but isn't it equally powerful to have somebody sitting in the audience making a statement?
If they make a statement, just sitting there.
Doesn't do it?
Doesn't really.
They usually ask them to get like a garland. They're like.
People up there wonder who was there.
They knew Stephanie, but they didn't know me.
The sheriff would look askance at you.
And I wore my back. I need to start going back. I haven't been since they moved to the new facility.
But we do, and I will put it in perspective, we used to have a Saline County Quorum Court member who kind of, and literally, Jim Zahn ran against him and took his place. Once Jim got over there, we started having a good, and we used to have a really good with Larry Griffin, because Larry would come to these meetings. We didn't need to send someone down there. But if we need to start sending people back down there. So, anything else? Again, Tri-Lakes MPO and Central Region Metro Plan. This is not Metro Partnership. Metro Partnership is up here at the chamber. So we just need to know. And we have people going to Metro Partnership, 50 for the Future. We got Kevin Sexton goes to him, Jeff Lofgren goes to him. We're pretty well covered at Metro Partnership.
What was that event that they held at War Memorial this last year? And we didn't have anybody there. And we should have. What was that?
We went to the hot springs. Bob was there, and it was up in the press box, right? There's probably what, eight of us, and that's what it was, it was a legislative dinner, so we covered things. But that's another one, I forgot all about that.
Hospital boards.
Okay. Which one?
Under community representation, hospital boards. Like Tom was saying, we have somebody at CHI, but we don't have anybody at National Park. Mm-hmm. Or.
Okay. We're losing people. We actually just gained someone on a state board. They didn't know who they were, but they got appointed to a state board. We just lost Steve Lux. He came off the economic development. Oh, what was the lady's name? She's tied in tight to Huckabee. She lives in Diamante.
Oh.
Keith, would it be of any value to have an educational effort in the village on how do you become involved with the governor's committees? There's hundreds of them.
Mm-hmm.
Boards, commissions, and so on, to encourage village residents to consider making application for some of the governor's most important committees to the village.
Okay.
I mean, an educational campaign to start with, I guess. It's not an easy application, by the way.
No, it is not. I looked at one for the State Veterans Board. Because they had a member who passed away, and I said, well, I wondered, and I know several people on the veterans, the state veterans board, I said, let me figure it out. I said, I ain't doing all this shit. It's like, it's too much work.
What about candidacy, like actual candidates, like JPs? You know, we need, it's great that Karen, it's great that we've had representation at Saline County, but Garland County, is that something that we should try to encourage?
That's always.
It's the same one that I sent you, is right. And we'll get into the question of endorsement versus, but encouraging, educating our villagers to play a role in the governance outside the gates.
Yeah.
Candidate encouragement.
Yeah.
We get into a problem when we start talking endorsement. That's not our role.
Well,
we're not here to endorse.
When I think about what Karen's doing, that's kind of a natural thing for her to pursue because she's a resident of Benton. right?
No, she lives here.
She lives in Lake Coronado.
But she has a business in Benton, formerly Benton. Yeah. So for her to pursue the Quorum Court seems to be a natural for someone like myself that just moved to the village and has no other ties to any government entity. You know, what am I representing in terms of the rest of the governance people that are there, the rest of the representatives?
Just face it, you're not a good old boy.
Well, I am too, but not here.
You weren't shooting.
Okay. You're not a lover to an old boy.
Okay, how about the last thing is our interface / speakers. Who else do we need to get? I mean, we can get Richard and Matt McGee. We used to only bring in Bill Sample about once a year, maybe twice a year. We didn't have him come every meeting. I mean, do we really feel that we need to have Matt McGee here every meeting? It's what, you know, they're doing it for FaceTime, but at the same time, are they gaining type of stuff there? You know, Richard, busy man. Besides being the state rep, he's still
the same thing with our school districts.
Yeah. So I mean, we just need to.
But with you changing the format, they're only going to be here what, once a quarter now.
Well, that's it. Try to bring them only once a quarter, and you know, just kind of.
What about the chamber?
Chamber folks.
Chamber directors, yeah.
Now is that Hot Springs or
chamber? No, I was talking about Hot Springs and Saline County.
And you know,
although
the one that's not on that list, which seems to be the linchpin of everything, are the county judges.
Well, I got county officials.
Oh, that included the judges.
Yeah.
I'd like to add medical.
To bring in for
that'll kind of, that's a okay. Broad thing, but so much going on in the medical field, I'd like to.
So just trying to develop our speakers. I mean, we need to get back in with some of the RDOT folks. We used to have a good relationship. I mean, if anybody knows someone who's a retired RDOT person living in the village, please have them contact me.
Can we advertise that? There's got to be somebody.
We tried to get their HR department at RDOT to give us some names of retired people that lived here and it fell through.
Couldn't you put that in the digest looking for?
I guess we could.
And what if they weren't RDOT? They were some other state.
Yeah, I mean, IDOT, MDOT, whatever dot.
Throw it all on the next door.
The state Department of Transportation.
Someone's State Department of Transportation. I mean, except we
I
lost a lot.
That in the digest and see what you get.
Okay. I wanted to just sit and kind of, this is more work, brainstorming, getting stuff out here. Now it's kind of our, you know, my job to kind of put this together so that we can start focusing and, you know, picking on, you know, Sarah, this topic, you know, it's pretty easy. Medical is coming to you, Ron. But we as GAC members need to be able to talk medical too, because we may not always be there. You know, or we're talking medical with our neighbors. Hey, did you know this? Did you know that? Building is back, so where are you? We're speaking, and I want to say with one voice, because we really, that's our biggest problem with the village. We have spoken with so many different voices over the last 5 years. And putting us back to where we want, we can speak. You know, we're speaking for the village. As GAC members, you are speaking for the village. So, Paul.
To your last point, or maybe it wasn't in there, I just dreamed it, but I think no group in Hot Springs Village is better equipped than the GAC to educate villagers and residents on the reality of life, the things we keep talking about. But I think our mission needs to be to accurately let villagers know who we are, what we are, and some of the issues that we deal with every day.
And Keith, to that point, you're going to put together the, who's going to put together our elevator speech?
That's what we will start. I got to get these in some type of format. Okay. Then we can start developing.
Figure what the high points are.
Yeah, I mean, I've had on there TP, those are the talking points, but that's our pieces that are going to come out of background. All right, what's our key things? And we can sit around and talk about that, because it's easier for you guys to look at it and say, all right, yeah, these are the three key things. This was, let's get all of them.
stuff as much on the table or on the board, because we're recreating some of this.
Are you having a working session once a quarter or?
We're going to have working sessions as much as we need them.
Okay.
So if this is more important, I feel right now, to get a good team with the words and doing it that way versus us having, now, there's key speakers that need to come in, but they don't need to come in every time. Like I said, Richard, we don't need to have Richard here every time. He's happy. He's done my conversation. Yeah, you don't have to worry. But we still need to keep interface with him. There's other ways to interface with Richard and Matt and all this other stuff.
Keith, to double back a little, go around the circle here. How did we, I think you said, or someone said, we went through 5 years of being the Tower of Babel, I'll use that analogy. How did that happen, just from my information? How did we end up speaking of many tongues?
Two things that I'll tell you that why this
and happened. I asked that, sorry, just because I want to avoid that.
It was GAC membership. GAC, no one wanted to serve on the GAC. GAC lost focus from the board. Didn't even know what the GAC did. You had, and then the second part was the churn of board members and general managers. As you went from about 2017 on, think of the churn we had. How many people sat around that POA board and maybe lasted a year?
2 months.
2 months. I only did one say, but we had one who lasted 2 months. All this churn. We have finally gotten a little more stability. How many general managers? David Twiggs handing off to Leslie Nally, who's handing it off to...
You forgot Scott Randall.
Well, Scott Randall to Linda Mayhood, to David Twiggs, to Leslie Nally, to John Paul, to Charles King, to John Paul. Finally, to Kelly Hale. We've actually had a general manager for 2.5 years.
Yeah.
Who understands this needs to happen. He can't run his... I mean, Kelly understands it. I need to have... What's our game plan here? And it didn't happen. And the same way happened on the GAC. We had some very well-intentioned folks, but they were getting... off into the weeds, and GAC just kind of went away.
And to add to that, all that churn, I think, you know, just the churn in the demographics of the community itself.
Yeah.
It has changed tremendously since I moved here 7 years ago.
And the demographics of our outside representation. You had stability when you had Bill Sample here. You had stability when you had Bruce Westerman as your state rep. Then we had some instability on our state rep on that side. We had stability when we had Lanny Fite, county judge, to that. So that stability has changed, and it's continuing to change.
And does the board of directors of the village, is it... how central is the notion of governance, philosophy, stability, sustainability in their agenda?
I think it's very important right
okay,
now.
So it's elevated to a new level of importance.
I think it's really elevated to a new level of importance because who was here for the February 2022 GAC meeting?
I was.
Who were our speakers that day? Jeff Airy, Daryl Mahoney.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And Matt Brumley was tagging along because he was the heir apparent.
Yeah.
As that happened, that created some, what are we doing for the GAC? What is the GAC doing? Because it did not It did not go well. I'll just leave it at that for the GAC. You had the two county judges, very powerful individuals. And I was sitting here, I wasn't a GAC, I was an ex-official GAC member because I was still in my Justice of the Peace role. So I sat there and knew exactly, and then what the fallout was happened. So I'm just leaving it at that. So.
Okay.
Well, that's what, that kind of spurred us. We need to get back. I think it was shortly after that that Tom Arwood, Jim Zahn, Terry Jackson stood up in front of you, Joni. I think you were already president, by the chairman. Stood up to, at the POA board meeting and said, we got to get back focused on certain things.
But also there's big things facing the village right now with water and sewer and infrastructure and this discussion about, I mean, all these things that are going to require
this is
the connectivity to these folks that we're
talking
about.
When you listen to Kelly talk about how much infrastructure we need to repair over the next X amount of years, you know, hey, back in 2010, yeah, our $6 million water plant that we had to do, that's minuscule to what we have to do now. There's a lot of money. To keep our what we love living here. I hope all you love living here. To keep it in a manner that we want to live here, that other people want to live here. So,
we talk about stability on the GAC. When I became chair, Joni and I sat down and interviewed people, most of you sitting around the room here. We'd gotten down to 5 members on the GAC, and one of them didn't come, and we had to basically rebuild,
rebuild
this committee.
So
now, there's some form of, that's been alluded to, of inertia in the village, in that a lot of people in the village have very short aren't looking very far into the future.
Attention spans, yeah.
Trying to be diplomatic, since I'm one of them. But so we've got to, our job is to keep us focused 50 years from now.
Well,
it's not just 5 days from now.
Well, that's the board's job, too.
Yeah, well, I understand.
To handle day to day, but at the same time, look out into the future. And that was the whole challenge we've had over the years. I think, were you 2005 strategic plan? General was
part, just going to say that.
2005 strategic plan. I was part of the 2010 strategic plan. Then we went through the 2017 comprehensive master plan, which actually, as a document, has a lot of the stuff that we're doing today.
By the way, is it online? I couldn't find it.
I don't think it's online. But if you go into some of the stuff, you get away from the town center and some of this other stuff, a lot of that stuff is being done. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's infrastructure, it's roads, it's
It was
water.
Unfortunate. That was a throw the baby out with the bathwater instead of pull parts that were
pulled
relevant
parts,
and worthy and then get rid of the junk.
So now you still have that, but down the road, you know, I think Kelly and Ken Unger and several other people have put together pieces of a plan to take us out to the future. We never had that. I will tell you, in 2010, the general manager, you know how many meetings he attended at the strategic planning group, and we met for 8 months?
Wow.
The general manager.
But maybe that's a natural progression of who we are. I can tell you how many Balboa studies were done, efforts put together, and there are pieces in what's being done now that came from study 2, 3, and 4.
Yep.
Maybe that's the road to success, which is painful and long.
Okay, I hope this was beneficial to you, some learning stuff, as well as going to be very beneficial to the GAC, because this is laying out our roadmap. This is our first stop to road, where we're going to go. We continue, we're working, you know, behind the scenes. I would tell you that, you know, I got the Bob and Bob team working on something behind the scenes. There are things that I'm probably going to be asking some of you to do behind the scenes that we just need to work on. Because it's not ready. There's so much that you got to do research on before we move forward.
on the information flow, several times we've alluded, and I talk to Richard all the time, he's working on things. When do you share, when do we share with the GAC, other than these nebulous references to what he's working on?
I think when he gives you the thumbs up to share. I think that's the biggest thing, is you can't get out in front of the state rep or the state senator. And it's kind of like when he talked, we shared it either two meetings ago, when he was had the draft bill out there. He had told me, you can share it. Mm-hmm. Until he says, share it, type of stuff there.
Yeah.
That's the key, because we don't want to alienate someone who's going to work for us. You know, again, he represents us, and he's taking that seriously. Just like I still represent the village, Western Saline County, I have to be careful, Western Saline County, on the Corn Court. And I'll do my best, but I can tell you 12 other people on the Corn Court have no clue. Well, I shouldn't say that. One has a clue because he comes out and golfs all the time. But a lot of them, the only time they get exposure to the village was when we used to invite them out here to host a meeting. And that's the only time they'd come out here. And Garland County Corn Court will not come and have a meeting with the village. They flat out said they can't do that. So, you know, hopefully Ralph Eds will be a, you know, good. Larry Rainey's been really good to us. He keeps us informed of Garland County. Type of stuff. Okay, I took up six more minutes than I want to take up. If you do have any questions, let me know. Our next meeting will be August. What I'd like to do in August is I want to bring the speaker in for a little bit, and then we're going to go to work session. So, because then we'll have the papers. I owe it to you to have the papers ready to go back to work session. So maybe 15 minutes of the speaker, and then work for about an hour on the papers. Okay? Good seeing some of you back. Be safe. Look forward to seeing you in a little
bit. Good job.
Thanks. Thank you.